Jeez Louise, what's wrong with you guys today?
John Travolta is a reformed school music teacher with a secret in his past. In Shout, one of five new movies we'll review this week on Siskel and Ebert. And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is called Shout, and this is a silly, trivial rites of passage story about a rebellious young man sent to a reform school in the 50s, right around the time of the birth of rock and roll. This is sort of Dirty Dancing with a backbeat, but without the performances or the charm. James Walters plays the troubled Jesse, who is drawn to the beautiful Sarah, Heather Graham. He's made a bet with his fellow students that he could nail Sarah, the headmaster's daughter. She's shocked.
You were using me to get at my father, weren't you? That's what this was all about? Well, I'm not my father, Jesse.
Also on campus is the music teacher, played by John Travolta, who has such a contemporary look here that he looks like he stepped in from another picture. In a bar on the wrong side of the tracks, he counsels the wild Jesse to let off steam by playing guitar. Another cornball storyline has Travolta jazzing up the school band.
Big boy, just play the bass line. Play the bass line. Da, 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 da. Good.
And then it's back to romance as the two soon-to-be lovers meet and exchange information about their similarly troubled past.
My mom died when I was 8. I remember that she had this one freckle on the end of her nose, and she would call it her kiss button. Whenever I would touch it, she would give me a kiss.
That's lame stuff. The only thing I like about Shout is when we go to that rock and roll club. There, the music is wonderful. But otherwise, choreographer-turned-director Jeffrey Hornaday comes up with one hackneyed scene after another. The lead actors seem like they're trapped in separate movies, neither one of which is particularly good.
I sat through this movie in astonishment. Yeah. I mean, whose fantasy is this about this world? I mean, it's Texas in the 1950s, but blacks and whites get along real nice together, and there's no tension, there's no racial segregation.
Right.
They all hang out at the same clubs. You have this relationship between John Travolta and Linda Fiorentino, who he meets in the second scene of the movie, and he says, I'm going to see a lot more of you, but he's wrong, because he only sees her once more, silhouetted against the outside of a window, and then she's dropped. It's a real mess.
There's a lot of cutting, and then you have the whole school. Which is really, I mean, you know, reform school, it's a complete jumble.
Okay, our next movie is The Man in the Moon, and this is, in my opinion, one of the best films of the year, a poetic and deeply moving story of two teenage sisters who are separated by those crucial years between 14 and 17, and have both fallen in love with the same boy. Now, I know this probably sounds like some kind of a dumb romantic formula, but there's not a false moment in The Man in the Moon, and there is a great deal of truth. In an opening scene, we meet the older of the sisters, played by Emily Warfield, as a local boy comes to pick her up for a date. Her parents are played here by Sam Waterston and Tess Harper.
You got a full tank of gas?
Yes, sir.
No detours, no back roads, no liquor. What time you got?
6:13.
You're responsible for my daughter for the next 5 hours and 7 minutes.
That scene sets a certain tone for the movie. These parents are strict, and they establish ground rules, but they are also wise and loving. A little later, the younger sister, played by Reese Witherspoon, shares one of the most important moments in her life with Court, the new boy next door, played by Jason London.
I want you to be the first boy to ever kiss me.
There's a perfection and idealism in that scene that you can really savor. But a little later, when Court sees the older sister, he behaves like an ordinary teenager, and the kid sister is crushed.
You must be Court. I've been meaning to come by to visit with your mother and say hi. Well, but I've been busy getting things ready for school, but I just didn't get around to it. But I will do it, I promise.
And that moment leads almost inevitably to a moment of pain like this one, which has a hard, cruel truth to it.
I love you, Court.
Don't. Don't love me now. When things are so mixed up, I've got more than I can say grace over right now.
While I was watching The Man on the Moon, I gradually became aware that this was a very special movie, and I almost held my breath, waiting for it to go wrong, to tack on one of those phony Hollywood happy endings. But it doesn't. It creates a perfect narrative arc, and when it's over, you realize that the director, Robert Mulligan, has created one of the most delicate and heartwarming movies of the year.
And Robert, I agree with you. And Robert Mulligan is the director of Summer of 42, mm-hmm. To Kill a Mockingbird.
Yes.
So
mm-hmm.
he's back in form. He hasn't been working very much in the last decade.
No.
And it's good to see him. This is it's classically filmed. It's economical. The points are made. And the acting is first rate. The young girl, Reese Witherspoon, mm-hmm. is terrific. This is like a Jodie Foster young performance. She's,
yeah.
she's right there, and her age, it's really not important. Of course, it's a story of a young girl at this specific time, but it's a full mm-hmm. character, not with quirky little things. When she wants to be kissed for that first time and have it be right, it's a beautiful, beautiful
that,
moment.
That is a great, that scene, her first kiss, is one of the most perfect little scenes that
yes,
I've,
yes,
that I've seen in a movie.
Yes,
and you know, at the end of the film, the dialogue at the very end of the film, which must have been thought about and debated and written and rewritten until they got it just right, and it is just right. This isn't one of these movies where somehow everything is okay at the end and everything's going to work out all right. This is a movie where these girls
yeah.
find out something about themselves and about life, and it's left at that. That's
yeah.
enough.
I had a couple of reactions. One, I wish more movies were at this level. I sure don't
yeah.
understand why they're not.
Mm-hmm.
Really, I don't understand why. And the second one is, as a parent of two young girls, this would be a picture that I love them to see.
Yes, yes.
Because I think this is the kind of picture, it's not the garbage you get on television a lot of, you know, soap operas for kids. This is something that they could really relate to.
I loved it. I really did love it. Coming up later in the show, a Liza Minnelli tap dance musical called Steppin' Out. And coming up next, The Super, an urban comedy featuring Oscar winner Joe Pesci from Goodfellas.
Do you like this car, Naomi? This is my car.
I'm counsel for the Housing Authority.
Get off the car. Off the car! What brings you to this hellhole in that tight skirt? Don't tell me, I know.
Code violations, Mr. Kritsky. The tenants have informed me you haven't addressed any of them.
That's Joe Pesci in The Super, the first starring role for the superb dramatic actor who won last year's Best Supporting Actor Oscar for Goodfellas, playing that terrifying mobster. He also played a bumbling thief in Home Alone, and I didn't care for his physical comedy in that film, and I don't like it here either in The Super. He's way over the top as the son of a New York slumlord who is given a tenement for his birthday, is promptly convicted of building code violations, and is sentenced to house arrest for 4 months, so he's soon sleeping in his own rat trap.
What are you doing here?
Nothing.
What do you mean, nothing?
Well, what else does it mean, nothing?
What, are you spying on me?
No.
You casing this joint so the brothers could rob it later?
Yeah, you really got some real choice stuff here. We can't wait to get our hands on it.
That's a movie kid reciting lines. Later on, Pesci goes downstairs to check out the sports car he left on the street overnight. Hardly likely.
Kritsky, looks like your automobile lost a little weight.
One of his tenants, now neighbors, is played by Reuben Blades. He wants Pesci to join in neighborhood activities such as basketball. The warming up process is beginning.
Don't worry about it. It's okay. You're safe. You're with me.
Yeah, like you're going to protect me if I get attacked.
I'll call 911 when they're done with you.
Well, anyone knows where this picture is going, and it goes there directly with a big character transformation in Pesci. The Super deals with a powerful situation that would have made a great drama or a really wicked comedy, but this is just overblown silliness with one stereotype bumping into another. I'd like to see this story remade right away. The Super isn't the picture it should have been or could have been. It trivializes a great premise.
You know, in a way, this movie is a remake because it has the same premise as The Landlord, a Hal Ashby picture
in
1970.
Right.
Remember, Beau Bridges yeah. was the rich white kid who moves into the tenement and gets to know everyone. But in that picture, there was a real effort made to make the people in that building into individuals. The movie starred Diana Sands and Pearl Bailey, and a whole group of really good character actors, and he got to know them and get to know them as human beings. Here, you're right, it's just a character transformation. He's a louse at the beginning of the movie, he moves in, and we know as sure as God made green apples that at the end of this picture, he's going to be a nice guy. It's so predictable, there isn't a simple single surprise in the whole movie.
I think what the people who made this film haven't realized is that with the new black cinema,
mm-hmm.
with the raising of stakes of racism, or the issues of racism in America, that we have moved way beyond this, so that the audience is way beyond this. They want to see the subject tackled, but written at a much more brighter, confrontational, real level. Mm-hmm. When we come back, Liza Minnelli coaches an amateur tap dance class in Steppin' Out.
If everybody will really concentrate and do this step right just once, we can all go home. Okay, hold it, hold it. All right, let's take it again from the top, all right? A little slower this time, Glenn, okay?
Liza Minnelli is teaching a beginning tap dance class there, and Shelley Winters is the long-suffering piano player in Stepping Out, a rags-to-emotional riches story in which every member of the class, including the teacher, is able to solve her personal problems and improve her dancing or piano playing both at once. It's almost obligatory in a story like this that the plot revolves around the group's chance to be in a big show.
Look, you already know a lot of steps. I mean, we just put it together, and we go out there and then show them what we can do, you know? Won't be anything more difficult than we've already done.
Bill Irwin plays the only male member of the class, a klutz who has trouble learning the steps.
5, 6, 7, go! Dot, 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 good, go! Dot, 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 Jeffrey! Dot, 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 turn! I get some items.
It's an old showbiz tradition, a disastrous rehearsal. 4, 5, 6, 7. Leads to a great opening night.
Can we have these? Can we have these? Great! I love you!
Stepping Out began life as a London play by Richard Harris, not the Richard Harris, but the other Richard Harris. And when I saw
the playwright?
Right, yes. When I saw it on the stage, it had more dance numbers and less emphasis on the personal histories of the dancers. It all took place in the dance studio. By opening it up to include the details of all of their personal problems, and believe me, everyone in this movie has one, the play gets turned into a film where tap dancing is therapy and the plot has to wait while everyone's story is updated. Sometimes even that doesn't happen. I never did figure out what Shelley Winters' problem was, unless it was narcolepsy, or how it was going to be solved before she was happy at the ending of the film. She's just mad during the whole movie, and then she's happy at the end. Stepping Out includes some virtuoso song and dance numbers by Minnelli, which are really not supported by the material, however, and not much else in this movie that we haven't seen 1,000 times before.
Yeah, it's pretty lame. I mean, what they're trying to do, I suppose, is make this into a chorus line for, you know, incompetent adults who can't cope with their lives. They also deal with some real problems. They also, you know, wife abuse and all that kind of stuff, which just seems totally out of place here. Mm-hmm. The only sequence I liked in the whole film was the stylized number late in the picture, Minnelli on stage doing an old-fashioned 50s musical.
Terrific.
It might have been directed by her father, and it was one sequence. That was great. Now, why not play the movie at that level all the way through? That would have been exciting.
You know, one of the problems with all of these characters is that as they come forward and they have these little difficulties and so forth, they're so extreme that the lightness of the material is all wrong. For example, the Bill Irwin character.
The worst. The worst in the movie.
Can't talk. Can't finish a sentence. I mean, this man
can't
isn't
walk.
This man isn't troubled. He's catatonic.
Yes.
And his at the end of the movie, it's not improvement. It's a miracle.
Yeah.
I mean, this is almost a religious picture in terms of what happens to him.
No, you can look at these characters and you can see that they're better dancers than they are showing in the beginning, and that they're much more full people than they are. And so it's a lie straight all the way through.
Coming up next, a movie called Whore, featuring Teresa Russell as a Los Angeles streetwalker.
Looks a little flat. Need a hand pumping it up.
Our next movie stars the risk-taking actress Teresa Russell. She has the title role in a movie called Whore, which is virtually a non-stop monologue about a prostitute's daily routine. It's written in a flamboyant fashion, but there is a core of truth and a little sadness behind her words. Early in the film, she's very feisty on the street as she negotiates with an Indian man.
You are doing it without a rubber thing? I prefer it without a rubber thing.
You prefer what without a rubber thing?
Everything.
What are you, man, like suicidal?
Yes, I am liking that too.
Well, I'm not into suicides, and I always use a rubber thing.
I pay extra.
You couldn't afford extra.
And she has to look out for trouble as she tries to flag down a customer.
Hi, darling. You a cop?
Later, there's a debate over prostitutes and pimps among Russell, a homeless man, and her pimp.
You know, you should be legal. Then there wouldn't be a need for him.
Make it legal, and I'll open an office. Until then, this is my office. Some of our regulars, they phone me, and they tell me what they want, and I deliver.
Maybe I'm nothing more than takeout food. Easy, quick, and affordable.
The overt comedy in the film doesn't work so well as Russell and her pimp go for dinner in a fancy restaurant. By the way, the waiter here is played by Ken Russell, the director of this picture.
Yes, madam?
I don't really know, sir.
You call him waiter. You call me, sir. I'll order for both of us.
Très bien, sir.
Horror works best when Teresa Russell simply talks to the camera about her life and her customers and their preferences. She's a warrior out there, and that's appealing. Little notice, however, is given to drugs, and the film's attempt to open up the drama are wildly uneven, as with that restaurant scene that I thought was really lame. Some bits work, some don't. I would have enjoyed this more as a one-woman show on a bare stage. I think it could be very, very effective with Teresa Russell saying the same lines.
I think it could be a one-woman show on a stage in the theater. I
yes.
don't think it should
yes.
have been filmed that way. I think that it's been filmed very interestingly by Ken Russell, who takes this urban landscape and kind of empties it of unnecessary characters. And it's not, this is gritty realism elevated to a certain style so that it's not supposed to be, you know, absolutely everyday
reality. I know it's not a documentary, but I think that by doing what he did, by emptying out the streets and all that, I think he was trying to do the very thing that I'm suggesting, which is make it a one-woman stage show, and that I would like.
Well, Gene, I mean, we're here to review the movie, not to recast
it
and put it on the stage. I think it's a very good movie. I think that Teresa Russell's performance is extremely interesting in the way that she finds a style to deliver this material, an attitude of irony and detachment and cynicism and weariness and finally loneliness and despair. And it's a much more realistic picture of a prostitution than you find, for example, in a movie like Pretty Woman, which would lead you to indicate it's just kind of like getting a scholarship or something.
Well, there are moments, I'm mixed on the film, I'm voting thumbs down. I'm mixed on the film because there are times when she does hit all those points, but in between that, I think the picture is wildly comic and flat comic. And
given the quality of movies that are out there right now, I think you're making a big mistake to vote thumbs down on this one. It's a whole lot better than most of the movies we see.
Well, coming up next, the video pick of the week, a gangster film from the 1950s.
And now it's time for our weekly video segment, and I want to start this scene rolling right now. Look at this, because it's one unbroken shot of incredible complexity, and let's see as much of it as we can. It's from Gun Crazy, a movie directed by Joseph H. Lewis in 1950, and starring John Dahl and Peggy Cummins as two sharpshooters, a man who can't stand the thought of killing and a woman who is thrilled by it. Gun Crazy has been a cult favorite among film noir fans for years, and now it's getting a new lease on life and lots of publicity thanks to a recent re-release on home video and an enthusiastic article by David Denby in a recent issue of Premiere Magazine. Look at the realistic way this scene develops.
Look behind us now, will you? Is there anything in back of us? The pickup on this thing.
It's all right.
You sure there's no one behind
us? It's all right. Go on, keep going.
Next time, stay in the car.
And we won't show it all because you really have to see it in context to appreciate it. Gun Crazy has a kind of crazy, obsessed genius to it. The story of two people who are locked together in a rendezvous with destruction. It's my home video pick of the week. I really recommend it. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show. Two thumbs down for Shout, the absurd 50s rock and roll juvenile delinquent rhythm and blues concoction. Two very enthusiastic thumbs up, though, for Man in the Moon, an almost perfect picture about two teenage sisters learning about life. We both admired Robert Mulligan's direction very much. Two thumbs down, though, for The Super, the disappointing Joe Pesci picture about a slumlord's transformation. And two more thumbs down for Stepping Out, the Liza Minnelli tap dance movie where everybody's got a problem and a solution. And finally, a split vote on Whore with Teresa Russell in Ken Russell's film about the daily grind of a prostitute. We both admire Teresa Russell's performance. Gene thought the comedy was uneven. And I just like to say that I really hope people go to see The Man in the Moon, because this is the kind of film that actually, like Driving Miss Daisy, I think, go on to win some major awards at Oscar time.
Well, I hope that Robert Mulligan will be remembered at Oscar time, because this is first-rate work by a wonderful filmmaker who is obviously back in form.
Yeah.
That's it for this week. Next time we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Frankie and Johnny, a love story from the director of Pretty Woman, and starring Al Pacino and Michelle Pfeiffer. Also, Little Man Tate, Jodie Foster's directing debut in a comic drama about a genius kid. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Flash Finish from Jonel. Dries nail polish in less than a minute as it hardens nail enamel to reduce chipping and cracking. Flash Finish from Jonel. Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco treat. Now with 30 flavors, you can serve it every day for a month and never serve the same dish twice. Delicious 5-Bar Snack Bar is a great-tasting snack that's a great way to get your fiber anytime you want. 5-Bar Snack Bar is high in fiber, big on taste. Ruppy's Sure Sack Trash Bags carry heavy loads and cost less.